Hey Ferret fam, welcome back to the channel. Thank you for joining me here today. We are going to be talking about everything you ever wanted to know about raw feeding because I get a lot of questions on this. Thank you guys so much for 9,000 subscribers on my YouTube. I can't even believe it. Do plan on doing my tradition of doing a live stream very soon. Do not forget to hit the like button, subscribe, and follow me on Instagram for more ferret content. I upload pretty much weekly, multiple times a week. All right, to start, so what is raw feeding? Raw feeding is nature's diet plan for ferrets, and we can determine this by examining their wild counterpart, the wild polecat, and what they eat, along with their oral structure and functions, gastric system and pH, and even small things like their claws and their natural behaviors. Most people elect to feed a dry kibble diet for their ferrets due to convenience, veterinarian approval. It's just the normal thing to do. When in reality, kibble is full of indigestible ingredients for ferrets, carcinogenic items. You have carbs, starch, vegetables, fruits, things that are inappropriate for ferret consumption. And some even contain meat from roadkill, dead zoo animals, even euthanized cats and dogs. I know many can be skeptical when I bring up raw feeding, so first let me just talk a little bit about myself and my experience with animals. I have 15 years of animal care experience spanning from horses to dogs and cats and small animals like ferrets. I have training and knowledge in animal behavior, care and health, along with nutrition for various species, but my focus is on ferrets and I love to be able to share with you all what I've learned thus far because ferrets are very misunderstood animals. A lot of information on them is actually just inaccurate and outdated online, so I like to share my findings with you guys and to hopefully improve the lives of ferrets all over the world. And year after year, working with pets professionally, I have seen them firsthand, declining in pretty much every aspect of their health. That being said, you don't have to listen to me. I like to think that since you're this far into the video, or maybe you've been watching a couple videos of mine and you've landed onto this one, that you do value and trust my opinion, which I really do appreciate. But again, you don't have to listen to me. Please be respectful in the comment section. I do not want to see raw feeding versus kibble, which is best arguments in there. Let's just enjoy the video and maybe learn a thing or two. Number one concern I hear most often in regards to raw feeding is, can't my ferrets get salmonella? And the answer is yes, they can, and so can we. So it's totally natural for us to be afraid of raw feeding because of this, but I'm gonna go a little bit more into detail on why we shouldn't worry so much about our pets when it comes to salmonella. One of the reasons is the ancestral diet of the ferret, or the diet of the wild polecat, consists of whole prey raw, whole prey mice, frogs, birds, carrion, and even though ferrets are domesticated from the wild polecat, they are still extremely biologically identical. Let's take a look at the stomach acid of the ferret. The function of this acid is to help digest and actually kill off pathogenic bacteria like salmonella when it enters the body. Pair this with a short digestive tract and anything that's left over will be pushed through so quickly they don't even have time to take root and affect a healthy ferret. For salmonella, the minimum incubation period is 6 hours, and for E. coli it's 12 hours. So food is long passed through the system since ferrets have a digestion period of 3 to 4 hours. When a ferret develops a bacterial infection, usually it is due to the naturally occurring bacteria found in the bodies of every ferret. The risk of us getting sick from salmonella is much higher than our ferrets due to the fact that we lack that defensive mechanism that ferrets have against pathogenic bacteria. We were not built to consume raw meat. Ferrets can shed salmonella through their stools, so that's why it's very important that we clean litter boxes with either gloves or wash our hands very thoroughly after handling litter boxes and their poop. Some people warn and say if you're immunocompromised, you shouldn't be feeding raw whatsoever, when actually I know of plenty of immunocompromised people that feed raw successfully and have been for years and years and years because they follow safe handling practices, so the risk for them is very slim. Salmonella does not just float around in the air. Conventional veterinarians will most likely lecture you on raw feeding due to salmonella, when in reality, salmonella can be present in kibble foods as well. More pounds of kibble have been recalled due to salmonella by a large margin. The CDC reports that in 2012, 49 people all over the U.S. fell ill when coming in contact with kibble produced by Diamond Pet Foods. In a published study done in 2016, it noted that salmonella can live on kibble for at least 1.5 years. Another study on salmonella and kibble confirmed that it can contaminate kibble ingredients or the production environment. Improper use of thermal processing can increase the risk. Contaminated ingredients that are not heated properly can be an issue. Recontamination after extrusion can be an issue. And consumer handling practices can significantly increase or reduce exposure. Unfortunately, conventional veterinarians and the FDA make it seem like salmonella is only a risk when feeding raw, when that's just a complete lie. It's sad that such a healthful concept is being pushed to the trash simply because of a bacterial risk that is grossly overstated when the same risks are present when feeding the kibble that they recommend. Number two, but where are the scientific studies when feeding raw? Unfortunately, there are not a lot of long-term studies proving the benefits of raw feeding because there's just not a whole lot of money in proving a diet that people can do at home on their own. The mass majority of studies done on pet food are sponsored studies by companies like Hill's and Purina, but important to note here that there are plenty of studies done proving the negative consequences of processed diets with humans. So why is it any different for our pets? Doctors will tell you to minimize the amount of processed foods that you consume and maximize the amount of fresh foods. So it's really surprising to a lot of people how this is just completely different when it comes to our pets. Two of the main studies done on raw feeding include one by Dr. Kolath and one by Dr. Lippert and Bruno Sapi. In Dr. Kolath's study, it was confirmed that the young dogs fed cooked and processed foods, they appeared to be healthy until they aged. The aging process occurred at a very high frequency and they showed signs of chronic degenerative disease. The control group fed raw were free of degenerative disease and aged at a much slower rate in comparison. Dr. Lippert and Bruno's study confirmed dogs fed a homemade diet on average lived 3 more years than the kibble-fed dogs. Many kibble promoters like to boast that all the benefits from raw feeding are purely anecdotal, which I don't agree with at all because the natural ancestral diet of the polecat is raw and they are extremely, if not almost completely identical to the ferrets. So why would it be different for our ferrets? This is what they've been eating for ages and what nature has chosen for them, which is the best testimony in my opinion. Some may say the average lifespan is only 5 years for a wild polecat, so how can their diet be really benefiting them? But actually, most wild polecats die by cars and predators, not by chronic disease. Polecats and polecat hybrids have been recorded to live up to 14 years at home. A lot longer than our domesticated ferrets. Number three, kibble is specially formulated and regulated for pet consumption. Why would big pet food companies not have our pets' best interests in mind? Only the label on the bag or can of pet food is regulated, not exactly the contents, you know, the most important part. Labels themselves actually are quite misleading. A pet food company that states they are this and that may just be completely the opposite. And you can read more about this in Decoding Pet Food Labels by the Cornucopia Institute. I will have the link to that as well in the description of this video. According to label regulators, pet food companies can use words like healthy, holistic, natural, and they just mean nothing. They're just empty words. They don't actually need data proving that their food is healthy or holistic or natural. It's just something that they are allowed to put on the label to make it look fancier. 4D meat like roadkill, diseased animals, dead zoo stock are also allowed to be included in pet foods, and no, companies don't have to tell you if they chose to include this in their foods, you just have to guess. The FDA has actually found the euthanasia drug sodium pentobarbital in at least 30 different pet foods. There have also been investigations showing dead animals picked up from shelters and taken to rendering plants. Massive companies are fueled by profit. A lot of these choose to include ingredients such as corn, rice hulls, peas, instead of actual quality animal ingredients and products. Foods that do contain organ meats and quality animal products are few and far between. They're very hard to come by. It costs money to be a good company. Number four, my vet says that kibble will help clean teeth. Is this true? This is actually not true. Research shows that all kibbles have a combination of hardness, brittleness, abrasiveness that increases the rate of tooth wear between 3 to 5 times faster than seen in pet ferrets consuming a natural diet, polecats, black-footed ferrets, or New Zealand feral ferrets. In practical terms, this means a 3-year-old ferret may have as much tooth wear or more as a 9 to 10 year 10-year-old ferret eating a natural diet. This is according to zoo archaeologist and ferret researcher Bob Church. This is due to the direction of jaw movement when they eat kibble, along with the actual composition of the kibble. This is something that I can also confirm based on my personal experiences with ferrets. I have met ferrets that are younger than 1 year old or just 2 years old with so much tooth wear that they require dental scalings not even when they hit 2 years old, which should not be the case whatsoever. I have seen many raw-fed ferrets in their elderly years have pearly white teeth with minimal wear and tear. So, I mean, there's something wrong here. I don't know why it's so hard for people to make that connection. Number five, are ferrets similar to dogs in that they have also evolved to be able to digest more plant materials and starches? The answer to that is no. Ferrets have not evolved to properly digest from or benefit from plant matter or carbs. There is no evidence that actually supports that they can do this safely. Even when it's cooked and ground up multiple times in pet foods, I've actually seen the polar opposite. Ferrets are developing diet-related diseases like insulinoma, bladder stones, along with dental disease, allergies, obesity, and more. All issues that are not prevalent in wild polecats or in countries where raw feeding is more common. According to Ferret Oncology by Dr. Nico J. Shoemaker, 40% of cancer cases in ferrets are insulinoma, tumors of the pancreas. We're now learning that insulinoma is mostly linked to diet. Number six, will feeding raw make my ferrets aggressive? This is completely false. I have no idea where this stems from, but I have heard it myself many times. Zero evidence to support this theory. The opposite actually makes more sense. Raw bones are a big part of a proper raw diet plan for ferrets. Stimulates the dopamine receptors in the brain, calming your ferrets and settling their heart rate. Feeding raw does often make ferrets more lively and active due to the healthy fats and proteins in the diet that they use for energy functions, but that's about it. No aggression. Number seven, I heard that ferrets imprint on their kibble. If so, doesn't that mean that it's impossible to switch them? No, it is not impossible to switch your ferret. For example, Tanji was fed kibble for 3 years prior to me actually getting him, and he switched to raw in about a week. I have successfully switched ferrets from 8 weeks old to 8 years old. It can absolutely be done. Now, does that mean it's easy? Not exactly. Switching to raw can take a few weeks depending on your persistence with your ferrets. And I created my mentoring program for this exact reason, for people who need a mentor. People will start the transition to raw and get completely stuck and confused on what to do next, or frustrated because what they're doing is just not working for their ferrets. I have had so much success with the program. Everyone who signs up finishes with a completely transitioned ferret or ferrets, along with the knowledge to properly feed raw and how to balance it. Number eight is, but my vet says if I feed raw, I will seriously harm my ferrets. I am torn. What do I do? This one I hear all the time. Truth is, vets are doctors, not nutritionists. Well, most of them. I have heard interviews with various vets confirming the amount of nutritional courses they take in their degrees are slim to none. My studying vet friends in school right now have also confirmed this. Not much has changed. Conventional veterinarians are actually sponsored by kibble companies like Hill's and Purina. These companies hold seminars where vets can go to learn more about pet food and how they can apply that into their practices. I do know some vets advise against it due to the fact people will always do it wrong, but to assume everyone is like that and to refuse to provide adequate resources for pet parents to educate themselves and do it right, that's pretty scary to me. Not all vets are against raw. There's actually entire organizations dedicated to it. Number nine, can I feed a diet of both kibble and raw? At this point in time, we lack the research to prove that this can be done safely with ferrets. They're quite different from dogs and even cats, so what may work for them may not work for ferrets. In my opinion, with the knowledge and information that we have right now on ferrets, I don't think it can safely be done. The stomach composition and gut flora in a kibble-fed ferret will be different to that of a raw-fed ferret. Combining the two has caused bacterial overloads in some ferrets and lots of digestive upset. I also believe that any risks that you're trying to avoid while feeding raw will be canceled out by the kibble in the diet. This is a controversial subject with humans because adding even a small amount of fresh foods is better than nothing. But if raw isn't being fed to a ferret as the staple diet, it's not going to make a worthwhile difference in my opinion and experience. Ferrets fed kibble along with raw will still be at risk of insulinoma, bladder stones, dental disease, GI issues, allergies, and glyphosate and mycotoxin exposure. Number 10, how much does it cost? So giving an exact amount is tricky because everyone has different situations and different amounts of ferrets that they have and different amounts that the ferrets actually eat. I spend maybe $150 a month for my 5 young and active ferrets who eat a lot of food. The form of raw you do greatly influences price. price. Freeze-dried and air-dried dyes are very expensive. Commercial grinds and whole prey can also be super expensive. Most raw feeders follow Franken prey. Unless you get discounts or have special circumstances, feeding a raw dye will almost always be more expensive than your average kibble. This is because you're paying for quality ingredients. With humans, buying foods from Whole Foods or just eating organic will always be more expensive than dining out at McDonald's, for example. Number 11, do I have to feed live animals? This isn't really recommended as it's very stressful for the prey and unfair to them because they can't run away like they could in the wild. The prey may also injure your ferret and then try to escape. Feeding live is also illegal in some areas. Number 12, do I have to feed whole prey? While this is the best diet option for ferrets, you certainly can create a healthy and balanced diet out of Franken prey style raw or commercial grinds, whatever you choose to do. You do not have to feed whole prey items. It is important though that we supplement those diets with things like fur or fish to help round out the entire diet and make it mimic whole prey the best we can. Greenlit mussels provide manganese. Ferrets not fed whole prey will be deficient in this. I feed one mussel per ferret once a week, chop and add to organ soup or boneless meat. Fish provides iodine amongst many other benefits. Ferrets not fed whole prey will probably be deficient in this. I feed fish once or twice a week. Mackerel, salmon, and sardines are all great options for ferrets. Number 13, I am super busy and I don't think I have time to feed a raw diet. What do you think? The beginning transition can take quite a bit of time on your part, depending on how persistent and how many times a day you're trying this with them. Once your ferrets finish transitioning, there are many ways that you can cut back on the amount of time that you spend preparing food for them. The first being feed balanced commercial raw grinds. These are great and balanced for you. Just thaw and feed and make sure that the company that you are supplying from has balanced grinds for ferrets. I will have links to the ones that I like in the description of the video. The next one, follow an organized schedule. I like to plan out meals for the entire week and write them down if I know I'll be busy. And lastly, make sure you remember to take out appropriate meals or items to thaw before mealtime. Number 14, can ferrets choke on bones? So ferrets can choke on just about anything, including kibble or their toys. Regardless of what you feed them, it is always a possibility. Monitor your ferrets and make sure not to leave them unsupervised with bone-in meats. Number 15, can I feed meat from the grocery store? Yes, you can. Pasture-raised, grass-finished, and fed organic animals are the best. Make sure the meat isn't seasoned, injected with saline, or preserved in rosemary extract, any of those additives. Keep in mind, you do have to follow a structured schedule, so you can't just go out to the store and buy any random meat that you want. There has to be a proper balance. All right, guys. That is all that I have today on everything that you wanted to know about raw. If you have additional questions, feel free to email me. I will have that down below. I do plan on posting a lot more raw feeding content on here, so make sure that you subscribe, like, and hit the notification bell so you do not miss an upload. All right, guys, I'll see you in my next video. Bye.